depth on why the jobs numbers have been lower than expected and the numbers of people leaving jobs by choice higher than it has ever been. Joining us now from Louisville, Kentucky, is an associate professor of economics at Bellarmine University who earned a PhD in economics at George Mason. Dr. Abby Hall Blanco, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Well, let's start with the current job situation. We saw record unemployment during the height of the pandemic, but now fewer than 200,000 jobs were added last month, and at the same time, more than 4 million people quit. What does this all mean to you?
So there's a lot of different things that we could potentially look at. So some people are looking at this in a very glass half empty way, so pointing out that the job growth numbers were lower than expected. But there's also a lot of good news in this report. So we are seeing consistent growth. So we did add almost 200,000 jobs in the month of September. But the other thing too that we can look at is the overall unemployment rate, which is now at 4.8%, down from 5.2%. And that is a really impressive rebound in a short period of time. So just 17 months after the official end of this most recent recession, we're at this level of unemployment. For perspective, after the 2008-2009 recession, we didn't hit 4.8% until 6.5 years after the end of the recession.
Good point. I remember it well. Those were really challenging times and took a long time to come back from that. You know, so many people struggled during the pandemic and are still struggling today. Most of the special COVID-related government assistance is ending. So why is it still happening that we're not seeing people rejoin the workforce?
So there are a few different things that are going on. So one of the big questions after the federal subsidy for the unemployment benefit expired was, is that going to push more people into the labor force? And we haven't really seen that big jump that some anticipated. It could be that it's too early to really see the effects of the expiration of that benefit, or it could be that it just really wasn't keeping a lot of people out of the labor force. We just really don't know yet. But there are other things that we can talk about as well in keeping people away from work. So one of the things that we've seen over the last several months is the labor force participation rate. So the number of people who could be working that choose to work has remained pretty flat. And so that would indicate to us that there are other factors that are keeping them out. So one big concern that a lot of people have raised are issues surrounding childcare. So we've seen a lot of people leaving that sector in terms of work. And so people who might otherwise choose to work are instead staying home in order to care for family members or continue with remote learning and so on.
Yeah, the childcare issue is a crisis as families wanted to get back to work, and so many childcare centers have not been able to reopen. You know, I can't remember a time though recently when we've had so many workers in the driver's seat. It's usually not like that. People are desperate to hold on to their jobs, keep their health insurance, and now there seems to be more options as so many companies are begging for workers. Workers are being a little more choosy.
Right. And so one of the things that we're seeing right now is a really different labor market than what we've been used to seeing in recent years. And so a lot of people have real questions about, well, how is it that you have so many people who are looking for a job? And it seems like every, you know, restaurant, retail store is looking for employees, but they can't seem to find people to fill those spots. And one of the things that we look at as economists is what are called structural changes in the economy. And sometimes the workers that are available are not the same types of workers that firms are really looking to hire. So there's this mismatch of skill set. So it could be that the workers who are looking for jobs are not well suited to working in these particular sectors that are hiring.
And you know, we also have seen the increase in Social Security coming, but at the same time, the price of so many things such as heat and other necessities are going up at a rate many times higher. Is inflation becoming a bigger problem now?
So the Federal Reserve and a variety of economists have suggested that the increases in prices that we've seen for things like groceries and gasoline, and coming up soon in a lot of places, things like heat, have suggested that those price increases are temporary or transitory. There is a reason to believe that that might be the case, but some of this may be sticking around for a bit longer. Again, it's one of those only time will tell. But as you mentioned, Social Security is getting a bump. This is due to what's called a cost of living adjustment, or a COLA. And so what this is pegged to is what's called the Consumer Price Index, or CPI. And this is an index that looks at what is happening to the prices of a variety of goods and services that people buy. And so over the course of the next year, individuals who are receiving those benefits can expect to see an almost 6% increase in their benefit. And for perspective, this is the largest jump since 1982.
We'll end on that one. Thank you so much for your insights and your expertise, Dr. Abby Hall Blanco, for us. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. What?